Good evening. Thank you for coming. My name is Richard Cooper. I am President and CEO of NY Spin. We take a few moments to thank our sponsors. We are pleased to be hosted by Capital One tonight. Our other sponsors are CooperPresents.com, Pearson Education, O'Reilly Media, Auerbach Publications, Pragmatic Bookshelf, and Wiley, the New York chapter of the Internet Society. PNY considers NY Spin to be a Category B education provider. In the early days of what was once known as CitySpin, Peter was an active participant and a member of the steering committee, helping to organize many of the events. We're happy to have him back, even if it's just for one night, to provide us with a methodology for aligning organizational objectives. Ladies and gentlemen, Peter Morales.
All right, so I'll tell you a little bit about myself, just very briefly. I started out in the defense world a long time ago, in the 80s, working as an electrical engineer, designing diagnostic systems for the F-18. When the whole industry changed, a bunch of us from that world came in and worked on the Wall Street side, ended up working at the company called SIAC, which is where I met Richard. And there we were wholly owned by the New York Stock Exchange, American Stock Exchange, and ultimately ended up in that whole integration with the New York Stock Exchange and Archipelago, Euronext, and ICE, and so on. Around that time, I decided I wanted to do, instead of doing another master's, I wanted to do a PhD, so I went back and finished my PhD in computer science, and I met a guy who was running technology for the law school at NYU. He asked me to come on as the director of his project management office, eventually became the chief technology officer for the law school, became the chief information officer for the engineering school, and now I work for global technology, still working for the same guy all these years. So that's how, in a roundabout way, I'm here. When I met Richard, I was with SIAC, the New York Stock Exchange, and you know, we were doing some pretty cool stuff then. A lot of it, which is very relevant and pertinent today, well, I was at SIAC at the time, and he was running the. yeah, that was a long time ago. So time passes. It's kind of shocking and surprising at times. All right, so let me try switching here. Okay, so one of the common themes that I've been struggling with from the very first days of even in the defense world is trying to figure out why projects would go off the rails. And it was never really a technology problem, it was a people problem. And a lot of it was trying to figure out how to get alignment between a sponsor or a stakeholder, in the PMI jargon, is anyone who's affected by the project, right? So how do you get that kind of alignment? And it's not easy. It doesn't happen naturally. When I saw different industries did it in different ways. On Wall Street, it was really the person who talked the loudest or the fastest or had the most charisma. And people, you know, throw around the word charisma as a way of, you know, getting your way. But it's not really necessary, I think. And I'll show you a way that I think anyone can figure out, you know, how to get alignment with stakeholders without having to go through this really heavy process of trying to get people to line up without who don't really want to work together, who really don't have the same objectives in the first place. All right, so traditionally, when we deal with project management, we talk about the triple constraint, right? Which is on time, on budget, within the scope and quality, and you negotiate which of those you trade off. When you change scope, you have to change either cost or duration, and so on. Even then, you're going to get situations where you're not going to get perfect alignment. And the reason is, you may not really be doing the right projects in the first place. Is that possible? Is that true? Have you worked in organizations where you're building? And this is by the way a conversation. This is not a so please tell us what kind of project.
It was a regulatory project, so shocking that you would think that would be in very direct alignment, because there's a rule banks have to implement. As it turns out, the bank stakeholders weren't actually concerned with it working.
Right.
Their priority was for all the product groups to be on one platform, even if the platform didn't work. So, you know, mistakenly as a project manager, my understanding was the project was supposed to actually work.
Right, right. So. Did everybody get that? Yeah, so I think that's a common theme, right? You think you have alignment, and sometimes it's not even overtly stated that someone's not aligned, and there's a lot of passive resistance. Some industries are more adept at, I think, at passive resistance. I think Wall Street tends not to be so passive about it. I work in academia, and just because somebody's nodding their head and saying yes doesn't mean they're in alignment. It means that they're still thinking about it. And if you have 30 stakeholders, you're going to get 60 opinions. You're going to get on one hand, and then you're going to get the other hand. And that's not a disparagement against academia necessarily, but you know, I think it's human nature, and it happens that that's what that's way. You know, if you have an option, that's what you're going to do. So, I believe one of the strongest or one of the major reasons why projects fail in organizations is not due to, you know, traditional methodologies. Even if you get everything right, being on time, on budget, scope, and quality, if you're not doing the right project in the first place, it's going to still be considered a failure. So what I wanted to do, and this is what I've been trying to do for 20 years in some subconscious way in the beginning, and now more kind of formally thinking about how you do this, is how do you create alignment with people who want to throw things at each other, and that's not an easy thing to do. I mean, look at our world today. You know, it's endemic in our culture and in our society, I think. So, I call it butting heads. And what often happens is people kind of start thinking that they agree they want to do the same thing. They have a common objective, but it's not really until you get down to details that you find out that people don't really have a strong sense of what that means, right? There is no process for figuring out, you know, what are your objectives and what I call our value system or value framework, because that's what's really going to drive your decision, right? So if you're dealing with an organization that's going through some change, and there's certain priorities as to why you're going to do one particular project or have one set of features in a product versus another. That stuff doesn't really get talked about in the beginning. You start gathering requirements, and the requirements can be sort of catch-as-catch-can, and you aggregate them, right? So you pull all these requirements together, you track them, you make sure you build against them, and you make sure you have traceability for tests against them, and you roll it out. But if the features that are in the product are not in alignment with what you're trying to do as an objective for the organization, it might still be seen as a failure as a project. So this is, and forgive me, I'm going to throw a little math in here, and I'll go past it very quickly. But if you want to drill down, I'll also give you references that you can go to, and you can get really deeply into it if you like. So the proposed methodology, and this is the step number one, is build your value framework. What is it that you're trying to accomplish? And really do that in a very quantitative way. Not just, and this is another, I think, caveat, is you can rank things linearly, but they're not really necessarily equally important. The difference between number one and number two, and I'll show you a specific example, might not be a marginal difference. It might be a big difference. And you need to know those things. Later on, it'll help you sort out priorities. It'll help you figure out, you know, if you have to de-scope, what do you take out of scope? So I'm going to introduce something called the analytic hierarchy process. Is anybody familiar with that? That's awesome, because normally there isn't a hand. It's a kind of a very archaic or It's actually very popular, I think, in England. I think it came out of, I'm trying to remember the university in England, but it's a way that you can use to rank items in a way that gives you a quantitative difference between them, and we'll talk about that. And I modified it a little bit so that I don't use the traditional analytic hierarchy process as it's taught. I have a slightly different variation that we can talk about. And then once you have that value framework, that's what's going to help you decide what projects. And so the methodology can be used for project portfolio management, right? Or it can be used to select features in a product, or, and we'll see an example where a company's trying to figure out its strategic direction in terms of where it's going to go. So one of the use cases that I'm going to talk about is an incubator, a company that was started at an NYU incubator, and they were at a kind of a pivot point, trying to figure out where to go. And they had some ideas. I disagreed with them, and I said, look, let's just get the right stakeholders in a room, let's figure it out. And they actually changed their direction, and I still am very good friends with the guy who started the company, for better or worse. Okay, and we also talk about how to optimize those selections. So it's not just about ranking items against a value framework, and so I use value as a way of getting rid of ROI as the basis for choosing something. I think ROI can be really dangerous because it can be misleading. It's a made up number, especially early on when you don't know what the market is and you're trying to figure out what value you're going to get back. So a decision based on ROI usually is based on whoever is pushing the project and what they believe the ROI is going to be. And that's shaky ground, I think. So you have to find another way to come up with this value framework, which I think makes more sense. But you also have to look at costs, like budget, staff, and so on. Once you get to that point, once you have value and risk or value and cost, you can use traditional portfolio management techniques like efficient frontier analysis and so on. And we'll look at that a little bit. So this is going to be hard to read. So the first thing you do is you figure out, for a given goal, what are the components of that? Let's say, for example, in my organization, if we're trying to figure out a go-forward plan for technology, what are the things that we want to achieve this year, right? And once you have those components of value, you use a particular technique called pairwise comparisons that allow you to rank two things against each other, right? You compare two things at a time in a methodical way. What that does is it allows you to rank things in a proportional way rather than a linear, this is number one, number two, number three, number four, right? And that's the really important aspect that comes out of this process, is that you're not getting this linear scale, you're getting a very quantitative scale of value proportion to other items in that ranking method. All right, ma'am. Yes.
Criteria one versus criteria three, criteria two.
What yeah. Numbers? Yeah. All right. So let's say we have three items that we're comparing. Oh, sorry. So what does that chart mean? I guess in short, it's not an eye chart. It could be used as an eye chart. So basically, what we're doing is we're taking the items that we're going to rank and putting them on this matrix. And what you do is, and I'll show you this in detail, so this is just sort of like an introduction to it, but basically comparing criterion number one versus criterion number two. Criterion number one against number one is always a one. It's always going to be, you know, kind of the same value, right? They're equally important, let's say. But when you're looking at criterion number one versus criterion number three, and I'll talk about what that scale means, You can say, is this more important, less important, as important, much less important, and so on. And out of that comes the way you rank or you assign weights to those values. So, and if you see it, it's kind of half symmetrical. So this is the Rho geometric mean method. So the only thing that really matters is you only need to do these comparisons that are in white, because the inverses are automatically defined for you. Everything on the diagonal is comparing itself to self, so it's always equivalent. Does that make sense? Okay. And then there's, yes, sir?
So roughly that says that criteria two is five times more important than criteria one?
Our criteria, yes, for this hypothetical example. I'll show you a concrete example. And by the way, Klaus Gopal has a bunch of Excel spreadsheets that he posts. He has a particular methodology for using it that I don't use exactly the way he does, but it's really very useful. It's a good starting point. I also have some Python models that I developed to do this in a more scalable way, but they're just really painful to maintain, so I haven't maintained them for a while. If anybody knows Python and would like to volunteer, that would be awesome. I actually teach Python now, but all right. So, so the way you come up with the rankings, the pairwise comparisons, I use a linear scale. There's a lot of really interesting theory behind the psychology of why things rank in a particular way. There are conferences on this stuff. I didn't know that. I found that out. That the paper at the bottom is a very good paper that talks about some of those things. It's out of scope for our conversation today, unfortunately. I use the linear method at the top, and it works reasonably well. Some of the others, I think, will give you a more enhanced way of seeing differences, right? So sometimes, and this is one of the possibilities that can come out of this, is everything is equally weighted, you know, because you have to find a way to exploit the differences and to show them, be able to see the differences. I don't have any experience with the other ones, so I can't attest to any of the methods other than the linear approach, and that's what we're going to talk about today. So the first thing we did was develop the value framework. I'm sorry? Yes, sir.
If you're dealing with, say, 20 different stakeholders, and you have criteria one, stakeholder one says criteria one is three times more valuable than criteria three.
Yeah.
But stakeholder two says something different.
Right.
Stakeholder three says something different.
Absolutely.
So
absolutely, yes.
How do you handle something like that?
Well, so you average them, or you can average them, or you can find ways to aggregate the result. So it's the voice of the community, not the voice of an individual. I mean, that's the whole purpose behind the tool, and that's why it gets kind of messy and on the back end and doing this. Or you can go into a room and agree to agree. And say, let's together figure that out and talk about it. There's actually value in doing that as well. And the reason is, if somebody has a good basis for their argument and you haven't thought about it, and I rank it independently and I hadn't thought of that, that's going to influence my decision. So you end up coming out with a different result. Having said that, the result is going to be a group think, you know, result potentially, right? So you have to be on guard that you're not going to get, you know, dominating forces in a room kind of steering the voice in a particular direction. So, you know, sometimes it's good to do both if you can. You know, do the first one, you send it out, you let people kind of vote on their own, then you get together and say, here's what the aggregate came out as. Does it make sense? That's a key, though, is you have to, at the end, say, when you calculate the, when you come up with this value framework, is get everyone in the room to agree, does this make sense? Is this rational? Not about the choices that they're going to make, but about the value framework. Is this twice as important as this? When we're doing the next layer, which is comparing options against that. But yeah, great question. All right, so I think we talked about rank the options through the value framework. And all right, so let me show you an example. And I won't mention the organization, but we were trying to figure out how to come up with a portfolio of projects for the year. We had no agreement. There was a lot of differences in opinion. The dean was involved. Now I gave away a little bit of information, but there were other folks who had, you know, weighty opinions. They were, and they're used to getting their way. They're used to wanting something and getting their way. But we didn't have clear alignment. So I said, let's try this and see what comes out of it. And it was really interesting because I had a very specific agenda when I went into this. I was one of the stakeholders. I came out losing, and it was okay. My choices were wrong, and I learned, and it was okay. And I'll show you why. Here are the five things, you know, we came up with as value propositions for the organization. Number one was improve external, and this means student, faculty, user experience. Number two was internal or administrator user experience. Three was improve operational efficiency of our infrastructure. Four was improve the operational efficiency of our applications. And five was to develop competitive differentiators, right? So these are kind of vague, you know, to some extent, but they're, you know, aspirational goals that the organization had, and there'd been talk around these kinds of things. We never really pulled together, and like in one view. So everybody agreed, sir.
Peter, would you mind backing up just one slide? I saw
sure.
The first part that said there were many disagreements, and that's natural.
Yeah.
I'd like to see what those next two lines were. I missed them.
Oh,
please.
Sure.
Thank you.
Is this the one?
Yes, that's it. Thank you.
Okay.
And the third bullet then, you stand
right.
By no one was willing to give ground
yes.
in these disagreements. Thank you.
Yes, yes, yes. Somebody has to lose. Or it's perceived as a loss when it becomes an emotional entanglement where people are trying to be somebody's going to win, somebody's going to lose in an argument, in a headbutting challenge, right? That's a problem. You know, is there a way that we can come up with a framework that allows people to be wrong in a safe way, or right in a safe way? And that's part of what this is about.
Could you just mention
sir,
what's
sorry.
Different? I don't know if it's important. That point here on this slide.
Yeah.
What would be an example of a competitive differentiator? You mean something comparing?
Well, so. Let's say, hypothetically, this is a law school, and you're trying to attract faculty and students, and how do you do that? I mean, what? And there's lots of things that go into rankings for an organization. How do you increase your rankings? How do you improve the way people look at your organization? So those are the kinds of things that went into that bucket, into the competitive differentiators.
Like everything here is just all over the place.
Yeah. And then how do you rationalize that, right? Yeah. I mean, that's part of the problem, is that you have, you know, a lot of stakeholders with different opinions about what's important for the organization, and everyone is going to think that everybody else is wrong and what I want is the right thing. So how do you rationalize that? And that's what the process is about. All right. So the method I use is when I did the pairwise. Sir.
I may be jumping the gun here. Importance is can be difficult to quantify. When I was looking at the previous slide, those five items.
Yeah.
How much does scale factor in? Like, if number five, competitive differences, that could be 10 times the size of all of the other ones combined.
Yeah.
And the most important, but we can't do it and do the rest. So the rest of them combined then become more important. the scale factor?
Yes. I'll get into that a little bit. There's lots of ways to handle that through kind of traditional portfolio management. So you want to measure value, and we chose the value framework instead of like ROI. You still have cost or risk, right? And then now you have a two-dimensional space that you can do an optimization against, and that we'll look at that a little bit. We won't get into the details of how you do an efficient frontier analysis. That's out of the scope for our conversation today. But there's lots of tools out there, and I can point you in the direction of those tools. So this is how you do the pairwise comparison. You say, factor A, is it extremely more important, and so on. It does become a little tedious, I have to say, when you have to go through each one and think about, what does this mean versus this. But at least it isolates the comparison. Whereas if you're comparing everything together, it's much harder, and people just sort of go, well, 1, 2, 3, I don't care, whatever, right? That's what happens. This helps you get through, even if it's a little more tedious, it helps you get through the process in a more rational way.
So if you do this with each factor, against each other factor?
Yes, and that was that matrix that you saw. That's exactly what you were doing, is you were comparing each factor against the other factors.
Five, list of five things would be
4 to 20. Yes. Right. So in this case, we had 5 by 5, and we did the ranking. So if it's extremely more important, it gets a value of 9. If it's extremely less important, and the way you read it is, you start out with external user experience is as important as external user experience, right? That makes sense. So everything on the diagonal is equally important. External user experience against internal user experience. Turns out external user experience is more important than, and you could disagree on whether it's much more important or more important, but you go through a process either as a group or individually, and then come out with this, and you can get through it. For 5 by 5, it's not that bad. You don't want to do this for 20 by 20 because then you're talking about 2%, 3%, which then doesn't make sense in terms of being able to make any kind of basis for a decision. You want to stay around, less than 10, 7, maybe 5 is, maybe not enough, but certainly not 20, right? So you go through the whole ranking process and figure out how they compare to each other. I have a tool that actually prompts you for each one, so it actually walks you through the process, automatically, and lets you, see them in isolation. Gives you a little bit of background about what each one means, because sometimes as you're doing this over and over again, it's like, well, what does that one mean? I don't remember what that one meant, right? You can get lost, but there are ways to get through it reasonably. So we calculated the geometric mean and the normalized eigenvector, and this is what we came up with. This is the ranking of the five items in the framework, and we asked the group, does this make sense, right? Do you agree that external user experience accounted for almost 50% of the value? This is the one I wanted, operational efficiency down here. I thought it was important because we were relatively inefficient in doing things, and I thought we could save money, we could be more effective and do more things if we were more efficient, so I was making a big pitch for that. I was wrong, and I was fine with being wrong. So the dean and other folks said, what matters to us is how the outside world sees us, our prospective students, prospective faculty, our peers. That's the most important thing by far. Almost twice as much as the second item, which is internal user experience, which is other people within the organization. Number three was competitive differentiators. Number four is operational efficiency of the infrastructure. And number five was operational efficiency on the application side. And they're big differences that wouldn't be apparent if I had done a linear ranking on these, right? If I had to pick what to leave out because we don't have the budget, we don't have the resources, we don't have the time, a linear ranking might say, yeah, you know, just pick one, right? Then this shows you very clearly where the value is. Ma'am?
So in order to get those scores, I'm guessing,
yeah,
you total all the numbers in a row,
yeah,
and then you added the totals, and then you figured out.
Yes. Okay. Yes. 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 And you normalize it, and yeah, which is you add the total, and then you divide everything by the total, each row by the total, to get a normalized version of that, which gives you the percentages. Sir,
you made a claim about operational efficiency that you thought by doing that you'd be able to do more things.
Right.
Which seems like that directly impacts the ability to improve the external user experience?
Not immediately, not in that particular decision cycle. Over time, the next time around, it would, certainly over time, but you wouldn't get that benefit at that time. And this is a snapshot in time. So at this point in time, let's say this particular organization, hypothetical organization, is trying to figure out how to improve its rankings, let's say. So that's what's kind of bleeding into the decision-making process. It's what's going on in that organization at that time. This will change, you know, in a month, 3 months, 5 months. It'll be a different story potentially. For example, if you had a hacking event, that would change this, right? Probably. So you have to think of that too. Is that really what you're looking at is a snapshot in time, and how that informs that decision making, and be okay with the possibility that you're going to be potentially wrong in 6 months because things have changed. And it's not really wrong in 6 months; things have changed. Sir,
you know, how many times have you run this analysis through using sets of stakeholders? And let's say the past couple of years or the past few years in which you've developed this, how many times have you run it through, and how stable has it been through that group of stakeholders, or those groups of stakeholders?
That's an interesting question, and I'll answer that at the end, because there's an interesting story at the end, if you will. Sir?
Well, number one is external user experience, but only at the bottom is efficiency, then I'm assuming that improvements to external user experience have nothing to do with efficiency, and more to do with content.
Yes. That's
sequencing.
Yes. Yes, and you have to be careful of those things because it can get muddled in that sense. Yeah, ma'am, I think he's sorry.
How many stakeholders did you have participate in the survey or data input into the?
This one was roughly 20. I think it was maybe 18 or 19. But yeah, and you don't want more than that necessarily, because I think it becomes you gotta get the right people involved, and that's something I didn't talk about that much. But the decision, and the right people is hard to. That's another whole analysis and story about how you get the right people. But certainly the people most influential or affected in the organization who are really going to care in the end, and they're going to be giving you the money to do it, potentially. But you also need the voice of the customer or, other people who are affected. So it's not driven entirely. It's influenced by the decision makers, but it's also informed by the community. And they're all equal voices. To a large extent, which can be a problem for some people at times. And that's why, at the end, I have an answer to your question. Ma'am?
Just curious, in terms of business drivers,
mm-hmm.
In business schools where they teach people how to manage IT portfolios, or conversely, in engineering schools where they're teaching people to manage,
right.
Are there any standards, like standard lists or a template that is widely accepted of common business drivers?
So the question is there a standard set of kind of business objectives and values? I think every organization is different, and you'll see other example or use cases that I'll show, and there were very, very different values that they were looking at. There might be some things that are kind of will reappear as consistent themes, like, you know, competitive differentiators is one that always seems to come up. Yeah, I think you have to really deal with the organization as that snapshot in time, and that's what drives it. Sir?
Just one quick question. When you tell that story later, could you consider the level effect, whether there's deans and faculty and graduate students we know tend to be at the very lower pit of the academic framework, if you will, but is there a leveling effect with the stakeholders and the value that they can place in their pairwise comparisons as you do transformation? If you just consider that when you give your story.
Well, we can talk about that now, actually, because everybody's voice is equally weighted. There is no, because the dean's opinion matters as much as the student's opinion. Let's say, you know, if we had one of the stakeholders in that process with the student, he has exactly the same voice, the same level of priority.
Thank you.
I guess that theoretically could be a hazard. If you have like 10 graduate students and one dean, you have one representing the business side.
Yes, yes. You want to balance the group. Sir?
Take this one step away from academia.
Yep.
And the book.
Yep.
One stakeholder is a senior vice president.
Yep.
Another stakeholder is just the manager of the unit.
Yep.
It's going to be pretty difficult for that senior vice president to accept the fact that the manager has a criteria.
That is exactly what I found. Yes, that's the kicker at the end. So you have to be careful with some of these things. You can't probably come up with a weighting system that gives one person more votes than another one if you wanted to, you know. But then how do you do that too? You know, ultimately what matters is at the end of the day, if everybody says this is our value framework, that external user experience is twice as important as, and everybody says, yeah, you know, that seems right, it feels right, then you're okay, right? You can go through more rounds, you can go into a room and battle it out or whatever, but ultimately, you want to get everyone's agreement that they're going to stay in the room until you have something that matches the snapshot in time of what's going on in that organization and those priorities. Once you have this locked down, it's safe sailing from there, right? But, sir?
Unless there's a change in management.
Well, yes, yes, absolutely.
When you basically surveyed the stakeholders, right? So when they were, I imagine some of them might have known what the other stakeholders already felt, but maybe try to say to people, just put in what you think, and no one knows but until you aggregate everything what the entire picture looks like, right?
So in this case, we did kind of individual sampling. I've tried another version where it was kind of a group approach. I don't know which was better, to be honest with you, and I think those kinds of things can bleed in when you have kind of a group sitting together and they start to listen to one person. One person starts making their pitch. If they're very influential, the whole opinion is going to start to steer in that direction. So I think it's better to do it as kind of individual blind study kind of approach to get everybody's view at least first, and then, you know, and then try another pass, you know, where you get people in a room to try to, you know, maybe if they say, well, no, this doesn't look right, there's something wrong with it, it's 47% is way too much for external user experience. I didn't hear that. I mean, they were like, holy cow, that's absolutely right, and that was the response, and it would not have been predictable necessarily going into the room. Which was, to me, interesting on its own.
I guess you could get the outliers to explain why they rate this so differently.
Yes, 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 you can do that. I mean, people do this today in, you know, estimation, you know, you do wideband Delphi and those kinds of things. I mean, you do those kinds of things. And that's a whole area of study that, you know, I'd love to, you know, but I haven't gone down that path. Any one of these paths is like a half a career, I think. So these are the projects that were being ranked against that value framework. So we had one project, which was a website redesign, enhanced disaster recovery infrastructure. That was mine. Developing a business process automation framework. That was mine. And developing data warehouse and reporting. That was one of the dean's. And implementing data center provisioning automation. That was mine too. So there's a problem here initially, which is you have to estimate the size, right? I mean, it's really hard. You know, these are budget numbers, really more than estimates. You know, this is how much you think it's going to cost you to do the project. It might be more, it might be less. You know, but you have to have some basis of cost to do these comparisons. So we went through a process of trying to figure out how much it would cost and come up with a budget. We actually hit them pretty good because we use Scrum. And so that means whatever doesn't fit into that bucket is off the table, which is good and bad. Then we did the ranking of each of the options against the value framework, and again, used a linear scale to say how much influence does or how much value does this provide for this particular for this particular value. And so you go through and look at all the different projects, and those at this point, once you have the value framework, I think you're way more than halfway there. This is actually relatively easy. You can actually, in our process anyway, we were able to come up with this in a much shorter period of time than going through the initial value framework. So we went through this ranking.
I'm sorry, what are we looking at?
Ah, so these are the projects that are part of the portfolio that we're going to select from. The costs were in the previous...
Right, the costs were in the previous slide.
Right.
Okay.
Sir.
Yeah, so this was just a real aha moment for me. It's like, oh, it's not like one project, disaster recovery, only works for one aspect.
Right. It could have influence, yes.
Every project affects every business value.
It can, yes. There can be bleed over between the projects. Somebody else had their hand up. Sir.
When did you put the dollar amounts on the projects? When in the process did you? Was it before or after the criteria?
It was independent of. So it was actually done by the project teams, and the value framework was being done with really more kind of like the executive group. So the project teams themselves, and that's what you want. You know, you want whoever's going to estimate how much work it's going to take has to be, first of all, have the best knowledge of that. Second of all, agree to that. It becomes a contract. That's one of the things that comes out of this, by the way, is if you involve all the stakeholders, including the project teams, and they have a voice in, you know, how much something's going to cost, or and you come up with an estimate, ultimately you get agreements on multiple levels. You get agreements from the teams to say, okay, we're gonna implement this. We are on board. Now you can sort of force that in the way you deliver a lot of this stuff, so that they know they're actually being, you know, there is going to be a contract of sorts involved, if you will, sir.
Two questions. Can you go back to one slide?
Yep.
The dollar values that you have.
Right.
Is that cumulative for the? If you will, kind of the spend for the year?
Yes.
Okay, so all of those, in theory, can be done?
No.
So,
not necessarily. Potentially.
Okay.
Which is where we're, yes.
Now if we go to the next slide.
Right.
The way those are structured, are they linear?
Sorry.
Yeah, right there. Are they, in other words, are they linear? Can I work on the one that's strong first, and the other ones have to be deferred, or can I concurrently work on several of these?
We don't know yet.
How many do I have?
We don't know yet, but and I'll show you how that this can inform that and translate into that perspective. So now we're starting to get into traditional portfolio management. We have our value, and we have our cost, and now you can start combining, portfolios or components of a portfolio to say, here's the cutoff line of how much we can spend. What do we do? Now you have a really good basis to say, you want to drop off the things that have the lowest value, right? But you can also say, if I got this much more money, look how much more value I could give you. So there's a dialogue that happens after that. Sir?
Is this maybe quarterly done?
I try to do it quarterly, and I haven't done it quarterly. I think it's very, very, it's reasonable to do it quarterly. I just moved around a lot, you know, and ended up in other roles and doing other things. And I'll tell you the story at the end, but sorry.
Here you have a 5-point scale, basically. 9, 6,
yeah.
1, and 0. Earlier, you used a 9-point scale.
Well, it's still on a scale of 9. It's just that the way it's
no,
separated.
But yeah, the value thing was extremely or much more, and then so you had a 9-point.
No, yeah,
so the relative comparisons are the same. 0.6 versus 0.9 is the same as 6 versus 9.
Yeah, and those things you can tweak, and there's lots of ways to tweak that. I picked a particular path, you know. In retrospect, I don't know, would I have done it differently? Perhaps. I certainly want more data, and I've been trying to find the right person to help me with the psychology of, you know, scales, which is interesting to me. Not my wife; she doesn't think that's very interesting, and she's going to see the video probably. Anyway, so does this make sense so far? Yeah? Sir?
Why is the value of each of them down there?
Well...
3, 6, 9.
They're roughly linear, I think. They're not quite linear.
You're valuing the extremes and strongs greater than the others. Of course you would. But I mean, it's disproportionately greater than the others.
Yes, part of I actually grabbed this from some of the literature, and I didn't quite understand why they did it that way. But I think that the intent is to magnify the differences. And interestingly, it actually doesn't matter. And here's why, right? If we agree on the value framework and everyone says, yes, that feels right, it doesn't matter how you came out to those numbers. If in the end you look at those projects that you selected and say, yeah, that looks right, that gives us a good basis. The purpose of this is to come to an agreement, to stop butting heads and come up with a framework that helps you have dialogue. The dialogue is the important part. The dialogue is where everything matters. So some of these things you can tweak. And I think there's lots of good rationale for doing something like that, I think. So here's what we came out with when we went through the analysis and looked at the different projects. The website redesign was the top project. Disaster recovery came in second. Business process automation, third, reporting infrastructure, fourth, data center automation, mine, dead last. and I was okay with it. I was, you know, actually sort of, you know, I was like, it's the voice. It's a voice of the community. And the dean was fine with this. A lot of the important stakeholders, they all looked at it and said, yeah, that looks right. All right. And now that you have this, you can start, and this is, it's the value per project, right? So it's not a dollar value, but it's a value weighting. Sir?
I'm guessing when you say data center automation, you've got enough infrastructure to support those other four projects. So
yes, not as efficiently, but yes.
It falls over. So
yes.
There's kind of an underlying...
Yeah, yes, there's a story. Yes, absolutely. This was at the transition to, you know, first hypervisors, the first phase of hypervisors that allowed us to be a lot more responsive. And I really wanted that. I mean, I was like, because I'm a technologist. I was like, I want that. But this made a lot of sense, ma'am.
This is normalized again based on the last chart?
Yes, yes. So you go through a similar kind of...
add them all up and then...
Yeah, yeah. The eigenvector geometric normalization process, yes.
I was going to say, it's like simpler terms that's been used.
Yes, yes, math, yes.
You add up one row and then divide that by the total of all the rows?
Yes, 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 yes.
It's a normalized eigenvector.
Yes, yes, yes. And anybody else?
All right. Was this only based on the previous charts data, or did it involve the other grid?
So this was the combination of the value framework against the measuring how much impact each project had against the value framework. Right. Right. So this is the value aggregated by each project against all the value components. So clearly, you know, we had our mission. And if we have not enough money to do everything, then we can determine what the cutoff point is.
Did you weight them, the categories, by the previous chart?
So what you do is, based on how much value you accumulate in each of these categories against the value framework, you're accumulating point values based on both the how much value there is there and how much impact there is against that value. That's how you aggregate points for that particular choice. Does that make sense?
So roughly extreme means 9 times 0.5.
Yes. Yes.
Are you saying for the first cell for business process automation for the first category, the calculation you do for that component and for getting you to a line item total somewhere, you're multiplying two numbers together, multiplying weight times the value?
The weight times
the weight of the external user experience versus the value 9 or versus the value 3?
I've done it a couple of ways, so I'm trying to remember exactly. But I think that in this case, it was we figured out how much value this is against all the others, and then multiply that against the available points for that particular category, for that particular. I'll send you my spreadsheets and.
Total 30.25%, I think, was the total number for that business process automation, or for website. How'd you get that particular, that aggregate number?
Right. So the intent is, what you do is you say, for this particular project against the different value components, how much value am I going to aggregate, right? So you can do it either by multiplying the values and then dividing it all. Eventually, it factors out. The scales kind of normalize. Or you can do a normalized version, which says for moderate, it means I get this much value. For extreme, I get this much value in terms of points. And it can be done either way. I haven't tried it multiple ways. The guy whose spreadsheet has a particular way of doing that, and he actually doesn't do this second step, which is the ranking of projects against each other. He does the analytic hierarchy process alone as a way of figuring out importance items. All right.
But the central point of this is you take the values and you multiply it by the impact, and then you rank them, then you stack rank that.
Yes. Yes. And then you normalize it. I should have thrown in a slide that actually showed the calculations, but yes. So once you have cost and value, you can start plotting different combinations, and then you can see on the red line are optimal values. This is the efficient frontier methodology. So any one of the square dots on the red line is a viable portfolio choice. Ones that are below it are suboptimal, right? So you want to just look at where you're at your cutoff point in terms of your money available, where to what project portfolio meets that criteria. And this is actually the wrong slide, but the idea is to do that. This is actually not representative of the previous slides. This is for something else. But this is what you would do. You would take the cost of the portfolio, the combined cost of the portfolio, and then you look at the proportional cumulative value of all of them, and that's where you get the possible value delivered for the cost for the budget available. And then now you can pick the groups of projects that give you the most value. And you can make a case where if you're, let's say here on a high slope area, that a marginally incremental amount of money will give you a lot more value. I mean, you can have those conversations and say, well, this is our cutoff, but if we had this much more money, we could do this much more value. And you can have, you know, a rational conversation around that with the sponsors. And this is an example of a selected portfolio based on a cutoff of about $2 million, I think, and how much value we got back. Okay, so the results were sort of surprising to me and to a lot of people. Everyone agreed along the way. Now, that's one of the critical aspects. We go back to why we're doing this, right? We're trying to get people to engage in conversation and dialogue and not just butt heads, and have a framework that allows you to move forward to the next step, to the next step. And so by the end, you end up with surprising choices that everybody agrees on. And you capitalize on that, and that's really the important part of the methodology is taking the emotion out of it and trying to make it more rational, if you will. And then it gives you a way of making choices based on constrained resources. So you can say if you don't have this much money, we lose this much value. But you can see that. I mean, it's a clear, you know, picture as to why you're making those choices. I'll do a real quick version. This is a completely different situation where we're doing help. This is a technology startup, and they were trying to find their path. After a couple of years, they were sort of struggling. They kind of hit a plateau, and they were trying to pivot. And these are the choices that they had. It was improve operational uptime, improve end user experience, development efficiency, cost management, revenue flow, increase market depth and reach, improve brand awareness. So they did this ranking. And they came out with, in this case, we didn't actually rank projects. We're just looking for a particular what direction to take the company towards. And by doing and the stakeholders were investors. There were also people who worked in the company, and they came up as the number one. They wanted to spend more on marketing and increase their depth and reach on the marketing side, which in retrospect would have been disastrous for them because they were already stretched. And a lot of the feedback from customers were saying that they were great, you know, they had really good technology, but it was sort of not reliable enough. So the number one thing that came back was improve operational uptime, and that's where they needed to put their money into at that point, at that pivot point in time for them, with the next most important as improving cost management and revenue flow, and so on. And this was also a surprising result that wasn't predicted when we walked in the room. So let's see. All right. So last slide. So I think we timed it pretty well. So it's not about really the actual numbers. It's really a lot about the process and how you can actually create dialogue and get people to actually work together who normally would be throwing things at each other. That is really what I learned about it. However, and this is the kicker that I was telling you, when I went back to some of the same stakeholders in one organization, I won't say which one, they didn't want to do it again. Here's why I learned. Who loses the most power in a situation like this? Yeah, it becomes basically tyranny of the masses, potentially, is what someone called it. But I don't think it is at all. I mean, I think that, you know, it's a very rational way of making decisions. But the people who can lead by charisma or by influence and by doctrine or by whatever, and lose that opportunity, lose that power, resist this on a second round. I don't know how to fix that. Sir?
Have you ever gone to this more than two or three times with a group?
I think that we've done it three times in one organization. I haven't done it really extensively. And this is, technically, it's a hobby for me. It's not my full-time job. I have a full-time job. This is, you know, just a way for me to try to resolve some issues inside the company and try to come up with a way to get past some situations that we weren't getting past. Sir?
So the reason I ask you is to his question earlier about the stability of the options.
Yeah.
I can imagine things like maintenance or improving operational efficiency will always take a backseat to other things that are website improvement or revenue generation until you build up enough of a technical debt or process debt where you can't ignore it.
Right.
It becomes very operationally difficult.
Right, but since this is a snapshot in time, and if that becomes a prevalent driver, if it starts to influence, you know, how your organization is performing, that will come up theoretically. I mean, I haven't actually done that, but theoretically, that's what.
My curious part there is, by the time it becomes a problem, it may be too late to be addressed. So, have you encountered that? Like, is there a way to elevate things that only can have a long-term effect that cannot have short-term?
It's a dialogue in the room. Someone who someone with the right experience and right, you know, having gone through this multiple times, absolutely could influence that kind of thinking in the room. So yeah, it really depends on the situation.
So have you ever gone back and done like lessons learned sort of analyses?
No, not formally. Mostly just kind of conversations with people. But yeah, I would have loved to have done that. It would have been kind of a.
You know, strikes me that might be an approach to
improving the organization. Yeah.
Taking sort of a continuous improvement attitude.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Sir?
Just a short mechanics question.
Yes.
To develop the value framework and then rank those projects, how much time did that take you with about 20 stakeholders? Just approximately.
Day,
two, three? What?
Well, the whole thing took about a week, but that was because we sent out surveys initially, and then some of it is going back and saying, can you fill in the survey, you know, multiple times, you know, so yeah, I mean, it gets into that kind of thing. And then at some point you give up on someone who's just not going to do it, I guess. And, you know, so there are the normal problems that you're going to have in a situation like that. You can solve that by basically, you know, getting everyone into the room and doing it all together at one time. But then you get a different outcome, potentially. You get the group influence, I guess, as a result. Sir?
I believe you said that after you had selected the projects, you used a scrum or an agile approach to execution.
Yes.
It sounds like your comment about an unwillingness to do a retrospective or whatever else was counterculture to an organization that embraces some type of a scrum and agile approach. So what's the tension there?
Well, I don't think there was actually resistance to doing it. I hadn't gotten that far in the I moved on in the organization, so I didn't have time to really kind of loop back and figure out, you know, a lot of these things. I would have loved to have collected more data, and, you know, there's just so many paths here, you know, that you could take to really gather information that I think would be really interesting. But so, ma'am.
Could you back up to the values for the
startup? Okay.
Because I'm not sure I know quite how to read it. Keep going.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, right.
I'm still not too sure how I read this.
Ah.
Got it.
Which one is more important than which one?
Right. So it's left to right and up, and the diagonal is always as important as, right? That's the one. So improving operational uptime is more important than
the end user experience.
Yes.
Okay.
So
great.
It's left to right and up.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions, thoughts, concerns?
This is great.
Yeah.
Where, online, where can I get more information?
There's a bunch of references at the end, and there's links to a site that has a bunch of publicly available Excel spreadsheets that do this kind of thing. Send me an email if you like, and I'm happy to help. You know, point in a direction if it's not in the references or the links.
How do we send you an email, Peter?
Oh, yeah, that's a good question. So it's peter.morales. At nyu.edu. Sir?
And we'll get the slides on the website.
Yeah.
I'd just like to say that this is a lot more fun. It may be more tedious, but it's a lot more fun than looking at BCRs and NPVs.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, my pleasure. All right.
Well, thank you very much, Peter.
Okay.